Hi, I'm Ollie with the Pacific Museum of Earth, and today I'm going to be drawing an Elasmosaurus, specifically our resident Elasmosaurus, Dorothy, who is displayed in the Earth Science Museum, suspended as she hunts. Elasmosaurus was a plesiosaur who swam the waters of the Western Interior Seaway in the late Cretaceous. The first thing I do when approaching a drawing of an extinct animal is to do some research. Luckily, you'll find a thorough description of this Elasmosaurus at the PME website. I'm looking for information about how this animal lived, what behaviors do paleontologists suggest it may have exhibited, what did it eat, and what are current ideas about how it moved and existed in its environment. Once I've done some research, my next step is going to be looking at some photos of existing specimens and identifying defining characteristics. I'm going to outline some of the features that stand out looking at Elasmosaurus to me. We have this very long neck, extending from a somewhat slender but still rounded body, with a very short tail. 19th century paleontologist Edward Drinker Cope, when first reconstructing this animal, accidentally placed its head on its tail because having an animal with such a long neck seemed absurd. But it's true! Elasmosaurus had a very long, likely rather inflexible neck that is speculated to have been an adaptation for its method of hunting, but that's still unclear. As I work through this drawing, I'm going to be describing what I'm doing and giving some general advice about how I approach drawing prehistoric life. I won't be going in depth as to my techniques, in part because I don't think I'm the best illustrator to speak to that, as I'm definitely still learning, but more importantly, because I'm drawing digitally, and I want this video to be instructional for whatever medium you have available to you at home. I'm also not an expert on prehistoric life by any means. This is just a hobby of mine that I want to share with you today. So I may make some mistakes, but my hope is that we can learn together as we draw these incredible animals. My next step is going to be drawing the basic pose of Dorothy. This is basically going to be the plesiosaur version of a stick figure. I just want to give myself an idea of how I'm going to pose her. Don't worry for this step or even the next few if things are a bit messy. It's important to draw what you think you're going to need to render this animal, and these early sketches are just for you and for you to get a sense of where you're going to be going from here. Next, I'm going to be roughing in a really loose version of Dorothy's skeleton. I'm going to add more detail where I know the bones really define the shape more, such as, say, the skull. But work looser and just defining form where I know there's going to be more influence from fat and muscle for the shape. I don't need to necessarily be perfect here, and I'm definitely not trying to be, because I know I'm going to be referencing, at the same time constantly, skeletons of both Elasmosaurus and also other plesiosaurs with a similar body plan, and the muscles of living animals that are related to prehistoric marine reptiles, as well as those living today with superficially similar characteristics and living in similar environments. So I will rely on that for my anatomy moving forward as well. My next step is going to be breaking the body into individual, non-specific shapes. This is a helpful step whenever drawing anything, living, extinct, even an inanimate object. It will help you fill out the forms when it comes to shading and providing weight to your drawing. You'll have a sense of simple shapes that make up the drawing and find it easier to define. Now, working more specific, I'm going to be doing my first rough sketch. I'm going to do several sketches in this process, but the amount is really inconsequential. What I'm looking for, and what you should be looking for with each one, is have I captured the look of this animal specifically enough that I know when I lay my final lines on top of it, it'll be well defined. It's really helpful to start really loose with your sketches. I once had an art teacher tell me, you can't spend too much time with your sketches, or they'll become too precious, and if you need to make changes, you won't want to. While I'm doing this, I'm making sure to bulk out our Elasmosaurus. It can be tempting to stick close to the skeleton when drawing prehistoric animals because we have the skeletons, because soft tissue doesn't fossilize, but it's important to avoid what is referred to as shrink wrapping or skin wrapping. Living animals have muscle and fat and all those good gooey bits above the bone that help shape how we look. Imagine how weird you or your pet would look if your skin clung to your bones. Spooky. So don't do that here to poor Dorothy. A couple of years ago, it was found that ichthyosaurs, another type of marine reptile who lived in the Mesozoic seas, likely had deposits of fat or blubber below their skin. So it isn't impossible to imagine that other marine reptiles, like plesiosaurs, may have had similarly filled out bodies and are perhaps a bit more chunky than previously thought. Once I have a sketch I'm happy with, I'm going to start going in with lines. I like to draw with dark lines for a more illustrative look with my drawings. But like I said at the beginning, I hope you take what I've said here and use it more of a, less as a guide, but more as a, this is how I do it. You could try using colorful lines, try super crisp lines, or go more painterly like me. You could even go with no lines at all and go super realistic with your drawing, as is very traditional with paleo art. The world is your oyster, or maybe your ammonite might be more apt. Dad jokes. Woo. Okay. Don't be afraid to move your drawing around and rotate it while you are drawing lines so that you can work more smoothly and drawing from the shoulder through the whole arm. Now I'm going to start shading. Because I work digitally, you're going to see me laying down lights and darks without color. Because digital art gives the luxury of adding colors in a variety of ways, including laying them over already established shading. What advice I'd give here, even though you're just laying colors to, even if you're just using colors to define your values, pay attention to sculpting the forms with the shadow and the light. You aren't just adding shadow for the sake of shading, you're showing the eye the volume of the image. I'd also recommend, with this drawing, since Dorothy is a marine animal, to reference creatures underwater and photos of them, since light acts differently in that environment, to understand how shadow and light might change underwater. Next is color. I love choosing colors for my paleo illustrations because there is so much room for thoughtful creativity. My approach is I usually start by looking at animals living in similar environments to the prehistoric creatures, and even more so, looking at animals that fill similar ecological niches in those environments. Oftentimes, these animals have coloring that's adapted to the way they live. For example, many marine predators today exhibit countershading, that is having a lighter underside or ventrally, and being darker across the top, dorsally. This allows them to blend into their environment. If an animal sees them from below, against the light surface of the water, they'd be hard to see. And from above, against the darker seafloor or depths of the ocean, they're hard to see from that direction as well. I decided to take inspiration from the speckled countershaded pattern from harbor seals as they feed on small to medium-sized fish, and Elasmosaurus's small head and gripping teeth suggest a diet of animals small enough to swallow whole. I took the slight orangey tone and introduced a deep blue-black color from the colors of marine iguanas, not because they occupy a similar place in the ecosystem today, but as a nod to them being one of the few marine reptiles left alive in our contemporary world. Finally, I'm just going to be adding some details, adding in some skin texture, adding some highlights, and areas where the water might make her shine. I'm going to finish Dorothy up here, and I'll be back with you with the final product. I can't wait to see what you create too. And here is my final product. I'm really pleased with how she turned out. If you draw Dorothy too, post her online and tag us here at the PME. Remember, in reconstructing prehistoric animals, you get to have the privilege of bringing back to life these creatures that we humans have never gotten to see before. So have fun and enjoy bringing back to life these wonderful animals. Thank you for watching, and I hope you have a really great rest of your day.